Good morning. This is the February 17th rescheduled recenter
reuse
committee meeting. Has everyone had a chance to go over the minutes from the January 12th meeting?
Does anyone need a copy?
My only question was, how many seats are filled on the committee?
We have technically 9 seats, and they are all filled.
Okay.
We kind of were operating with 10, sort of, for a little while.
Do I have a motion to pass the minutes as written?
Yes.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All right. Any concerns? Any changes? No? Okay.
John? The one thing, we did talk about the recycle rally on April 29th. That's been changed, but it didn't get changed at the meeting.
Yeah, we're going to talk about that.
So, yeah. I guess the minutes are fine the way they are.
Okay, so they're approved as written. All right. Do you want to talk about that, the April 29th?
We'll get there.
Okay.
We'll get there.
All right, the recenter report.
Well, we could start out saying that we had a great training meeting last Saturday at David's. David hosted it. Thank you very much.
I think everyone was there. That's here.
Yeah, that's right. We were all there, but for the benefit of the audience, the listening audience, and
both of you.
We had I can't remember the head count, but we had at least a dozen, I would say.
I think there were 14 people there.
16.
Okay.
Wow.
16 folks that are volunteers, in many cases supervisors and or intake people, to discuss intake procedures for the coming year. And also, it was just a great little way to talk recenter over the winter and get back in touch with folks we haven't seen for a while. So I think it was a great winter meeting. I think it's something we might want to do every winter, actually. And we had a lot of good discussions about different perspectives on how to deal with different materials coming into the recenter. So I think it's going to help us all to be starting, if not on the same page, close together in terms of our procedures, and also to continue to have the conversation when we have different points of view about what to accept and what not to accept. So I thought it was very successful.
I want to thank David again for hosting. It was a lovely thing to do. You have a lovely home, and you so generously baked for us, and it was just was really lovely. So thank you, thank you.
Let me update my count. I counted Karen's daughter, so
oh.
I really shouldn't. If you're taking minutes on the number.
All right, 15.
14 was probably correct.
Oh, and
then added David.
All right.
Yeah. Another bit of news is that Alan he's not here, but he's completed a report on last season, the 2016 season at the recenter. And I don't know if anyone's or everyone's had a chance to see it, but he did a very thorough job on that.
I think he sent it out to the working group, and I'm going to, what I did last year that I will do again is I go through the minutes and go through various groups to make sure that big things that we achieved are included, that they're all captured. So I will do that and then send it out to everybody, and hopefully next month we can approve it.
Yeah, and I would say here we are getting on to the past mid-February, and it'll be probably about 6 weeks until we open the recenter. So I'm hoping in March, when we have some warmer or sunnier Wednesdays and Saturdays, to get started on the preliminary cleaning, which it's not a huge deal, but basically the mice have the run of the place all winter, and the dust settles, and it's important, I think, before we open the season and stock the shelves, to get out there and sweep it out, basically, and do whatever else needs to be done prior to getting the shelves stocked and so forth. So
the main part's pretty empty right now.
It's pretty empty, yeah. It's not like a lot of stuff has to be moved around in order to do that.
If we talk about our opening, I think it might be important to get to focus on people bringing us stuff as you know, we'll be open to accept.
Right.
Because it, I'd hate to go out there now and was nothing out yet.
Right. Right. Yeah. So we'll be talking about that, I think, in the working group meeting. We also have some pre-opening publicity that we'll be talking about. We're going to try to get a guest column in the newspaper, which hasn't been difficult to do in the past, and probably Susan will probably talk more about email blasts and things like that to just make the community aware that we're starting up again. So maybe other folks want to add to that?
Well, I just wanted to say we talked about having the training session on the 1st and opening on the 8th. That was what we had decided, and so that means that perhaps on March 18th and 25th that we should think about going out there for cleaning and prepping.
Mm-hmm.
So if you could just kind of
one more time
put those on your calendar.
March
18th and the 25th.
Is it going to take two Saturdays to pull it together?
Well, there's also Wednesdays.
Right.
So there's and Wednesdays, that would be the 22nd. So I would say, I don't know, Mac, I haven't been out there in a while. What do you remember?
Well, I mean, I would say try if we can be flexible about it. If the first Saturday is good weather, just go do it. And then if we finish it, we don't need to go out the second Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
If the first Saturday is bad weather, then we'll try to get it all done the second Saturday, something like that. And I have this flexibility in my schedule. I can go out on Wednesdays too if the weather's good. So,
David, can I make a small suggestion?
Sure.
I've always been bothered by this T shape. Can we have you more in this group if you're in that seat? Do you mind?
For this morning, yes.
Just
generally, we're full up.
Right. Yeah. I'd love to get a longer table here and just get this T thing. Slightly oval. I'm going to be looking in the tag sale season. There we go. Thank you, David.
So the volunteer situation, I called Sandy Mendel. She has not returned my call, but I also spoke to the folks at the senior center. So Sandy Mendel, as you know, had come out and helped us and was interested in participating through the tax write work-off program. When I spoke initially to Linda Desmond, who runs that program, I said there is somebody who had expressed interest. Have you? And I didn't remember Sandy's name. I said, has anyone said anything to you? And she said no at the time. So that's why she came up with, I forget his name. I'm sorry.
Dennis,
and. So I called her, and she said that Sandy has jobs that she's been assigned that she's very enthusiastic about, at least to her knowledge, and that she probably will have some hours left that she can be like a fill-in person if she has interest in doing that. So I haven't spoken to Sandy about it, so I just wanted to give you an update.
And you remember her, Matt?
Uh-huh.
So what kind of volunteer is she?
Well, I don't know that that's is that something that we want to talk about right now?
I'm just wondering what she's drawn to.
She was drawn to grant writing. She had grant writing background.
Uh-huh.
She had more administrative interests, as mm-hmm. far as I knew.
Oh.
That's interesting.
Well, because, that's news to me.
I felt like she tried to contact you about that.
No. I wasn't aware that was her interest. I thought that she wanted to work out at the.
She may want
place.
To too
and,
as well.
Yeah,
I'm not
she
sure.
said on Wednesday.
Okay, that may be true.
Wednesdays, mm-hmm. I think I had heard.
So she wasn't at our meeting. That wasn't.
No. So she, she's a very skilled person, has a lot of different skills, and she's actually, I think, working on a smoking cessation program, either for the senior center or for the city somehow. So
I'm just wondering, did our meeting at your house give you any ideas as to how the list that's out now, the monkey list or whatever it's called, I mean, it's really long, and therefore, somebody could sign up for the whole year, but we have had people not signing up until the last minute or not at all. So is there anything that you got from the discussion that you might ring with a slightly different way of doing that monkey list, or slightly?
Sign up genius is what you're talking about.
Is that what it is?
Sign up genius.
Yeah.
No.
I mean, you're familiar with the computer end of things.
Well, it's interesting because we were more successful the first year in getting people to sign up early. It became a problem this year. So I don't really know why that was. We did use Sign Up Genius.
I think so.
The year before, right? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, so I don't know. I mean, I think it's just a matter of maybe early in the season getting reminders out to people that, you know, the earlier they volunteer, the better, even if they have to change later. Because then at least we have a sense of how many people are going to be there.
Right. So emailing that to the whole list.
Yeah, we only have 88 people on our Sign Up Genius list. Yeah.
Now, one thing that I want to be sure we do is that people who come to volunteer have had some kind of an orientation. if we're really desperate, that's something else. But I don't want people just showing up to help when they have no idea anything about
the recent. Well, I can't tell you how many of the people have had a training. I mean, it's possible they all have. I have no idea.
Well, so when we get morph that list into the MailChimp list, I have a list of people who have either had some kind of orientation or have signed a release.
I mean, to be the devil's advocate, I think Mac and I feel similarly about this. I feel very capable when people show up to train them while they're there, and I think Mac, you've expressed the same in the past, particularly because we don't have generally an overabundance of volunteers. So, you know, if people come out there, it's particularly if they get there early.
Well, that's the thing.
Really,
I mean,
easy.
if it gets busy.
Right.
It's
but I think we can deal with that on the fly too. I feel similarly that it's not critical that they have a training before they come to volunteer. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, it's not the training so much as understanding our vision and what's important, and getting a sense of, I mean, there are a couple kind of key principles about what we do and how we're doing it.
I just don't think it should prohibit someone from stepping up. You know, I think
that's
we can convey those things.
Yeah,
it's harder to do. I mean, from an employee orientation standpoint,
right. Sure,
it's much
sure.
harder to do after they've assumed or or done things a certain way. It's harder to change.
Ideally, of course, yes, everyone should go through that training process, but I don't think it should prohibit someone from stepping up if they get inspired in the moment.
Well, and I do want to say employment's different from volunteer stuff. And I found that very much at the survival center.
Sure.
They tried to run it like Coca-Cola.
Yeah.
And the volunteers were out of it.
Yeah. Well, it's not the regulations, it's more like these are our guiding principles, and that's important to convey whether you're a volunteer or not. And I'm hearing you, I completely get it shouldn't prevent people from helping out, but I just want to make that point that...
Don't we have a volunteer sheet, didn't we make up a
guideline?
Yeah, we do.
Yeah.
Well, it's a sign,
There's a waiver.
A waiver.
But there's also a guideline list of
sort
of this is how we do it.
Yeah. The 101.
Yeah.
So I think giving that out in
right
away on paper, even because people will have different levels of interest. You know,
right.
They'll be real gung-ho for
right.
and then all of a sudden, you know,
right.
et cetera.
I don't want to belabor it, and I hear what you're saying, and I agree. I just want to make that point that it's important to get people to understand what they're becoming part of early stuff.
Yeah.
So, any other recenter kind of issues?
You know, I guess one to follow up on the Sign Up Genius, one of the things, as you all know, I got down on my knees and I asked people to sign up prior to Wednesday noon if possible. And I guess I was wondering if there was, does it make sense to send out if that hasn't happened by a certain time during the week.
Well, maybe there should just be an automatic weekly email that goes out. Uh-huh. You know, here's your weekly reminder. The recenter will be open this Saturday. If you have time, if you're excited about volunteering, please do.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if I can set that up automatically, but it's certainly easy enough to send out once a week.
Uh-huh. We should be able to do it with MailChimp pretty easily.
I just think that's an important goal for us to work towards, is to get it staffed by midweek so that people who are supervising don't have to feel anxious about whether or not they're going to have a crew on a Saturday.
Does it feel onerous as a supervisor to send out a plea on Wednesday?
A plea to
the sign-up genius list.
So, no, that I mean that
could that be part of the supervisor's role?
Uh-huh, I guess, but check and see.
You supervise more than I do, so I didn't say that it should be.
I look anyway. I mean, mm-hmm. Speaking for myself, I want to know. You know, if I'm going to have to, work.
Wing it.
Wing.
Is that technically possible?
What? For the,
are you the only one that can send out a...
I don't know the answer to that question. Okay. It's probably true, but the way it worked last year was any Saturday that Mac was working, generally I was getting a phone call on Wednesday or Thursday saying, oh my God, there's no one signs up, you know, can you find some volunteers? So, I don't have any problem sending out that email, but I guess... Maybe the answer to your question is, if all the supervisors were administrators on the sign-up genius, uh-huh. then we'd all have the ability, because okay. I don't have any proprietary reason to be the only one that can send emails out. So maybe that's what we need to do.
Yeah, that would be fine with me to do.
And you know, maybe it's not all supervisors, but maybe we expand the list to five people this year, because we know who the five regulars are.
Mm-hmm.
But I think a goal for April... first is to have all the weekends supervisors figured out. As I said, we can always change. But like, I know I'm not going to be available in April and May, but after April and May, I'll be available a lot. So I'll do most of my volunteering for, as I did last year, mm-hmm. for the last few months. So so maybe how do people feel about that as a goal, and should we have an intake supervisor as a goal, you know, figured out ahead of time also?
I think that would be good, because that, to me, to make the thing go on a Saturday, you need both those positions, and so I think that would be, I would think that's a good idea.
So maybe in the month of March, I'll spend some time emailing everybody and saying, we have these 20 weekends or whatever it is.
Right.
You know, if you think you may be available, go ahead and volunteer. We have people that can substitute for you if you can't make it that weekend.
Right.
We're only asking you to volunteer once a month.
That sounds good, yeah.
Mm.
So I'm willing to do this year. I'll have more time. So are you looking for someone, supervisors or intake person? Which is more critical at this point? Like, you don't have...
They're both.
They're both critical.
They're both critical. I think... You know, I'd like to think we'll have plenty of supervisors. We haven't had the focus on intake supervisor in terms of, you know, that we need it and that it's an important position. So, you know, whatever you're comfortable with. I find both jobs really enjoyable, so I don't really care which I do.
The bottom line is that you can't have somebody that's new do intake.
I would want to be there with someone watching what they do 1 week before I became the intake person.
And that's what happens a lot, is the more experienced intake person will work with one of the volunteers that's less experienced, and there'll be a lot of conversation and observing of decision-making and so forth, and that's how we get new ones.
Well, also, when I supervise, if Diana's there, I usually ask her opinion, or Joan, mm-hmm. or Mac, what do you think? You know, it doesn't have to be a unilateral decision. It can be a committee decision.
Okay.
I went to do some signing up, and I noticed that there were only it's only one or two slots per Saturday right now. So
I think I just put the supervisor on. Are there other slots as well?
Maybe it's just the supervisor. Yeah.
So. Yeah. No, I have to expand it.
Okay. Great.
I think we talked about maybe 10 slots or something like that. No, that's too many.
Yeah, five or max, I think.
Five?
Five is general good.
Yeah. Right?
Five plus the intake person and the...
I think five total.
Intake supervisor and then three volunteers.
I think the fewer slots there are to fill, the more comfortable people are filling them. You know, when there's like 10 empty slots, I don't know about you guys, but whenever I go to those things and it's all empty, I'm like, why isn't anyone filling? You know,
I'm going to be the only one.
There's a tendency to want to complete a puzzle or complete, you know, you want to fill in the slot. So when there's too many,
three volunteer slots.
You can do 2-hour shifts? Is that how that works?
That's how I did it last year. I think, yeah, so you can.
So if you want to do the whole morning, you sign up twice, basically.
Right.
Right, okay. But the supervisor intake are both the whole morning.
The whole morning.
That's just given.
And the last 2 hours are more critical. The first 2 hours you can do fine with a smaller crew.
Okay.
But it's the last 2 hours you really need the whole crew.
Okay.
And if Sue Carlin is there, she basically acts like a volunteer, like in those early morning hours.
Really? Mm-hmm.
She'll help you with the tent. She will, you know, she's really great at pitching in. Mm-hmm.
Great.
Repair Cafe.
Yeah. So Roger and I met, and then Diane and I had spoke yesterday, and I filled her in and sent her a lot of info. And we had set out two potential target dates for our first Repair Cafe, and I've reserved them at Smith Voke. So there's a question of how soon we want to get going. We could do it as soon as June, and then we have another time set for September. So I just want to throw that out there initially. I was able to get the Repair Cafe organization manual, and Roger and I looked it over, and Diana has seen it as well. It's a very exciting thing. It's pretty simple. I think it's a beautiful addition to our pop-up event list. It can easily be done, you know, 3-4 hours and you're done. It requires some advanced research and recruiting. Mostly, I think the biggest thing is to find experts that are willing to help out. I also was able to get the presentation that Mac had seen at the ReUse conference, and this was from a fellow from Bolton and his experience. There's also, as Roger's mentioned, Pittsfield, and there are some other places as well that have them. This Sunday in Greenfield, there is it's not a Repair Cafe. What are they calling it?
Repair Public.
Somebody in Greenfield has organized
2 to 5 at Seymour.
And unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to go, but if somebody can go, I told Roger about it. I'm hopeful that maybe he or Diana, you said you had something
going. Yeah, I have something else, but I may be able to get to the end of it, at least talk to somebody who's there. That brings up a point that is just become clear to me, that Repair Cafe is sort of a brand name. So there are repair events that aren't all Repair Cafes. Like this is Repair Public, Repair Cafe, and there's another one, I think. But
well, I Fix It. It's a little different.
I Fix It, right, yeah.
It's a little different.
Right, so that was just new. Like, I hadn't really conceived of it that way. When I heard Repair Cafe, I always thought it was the same thing.
The communities that have, whether it's Repair Cafe or Repair Public or whatever it is, are these generally pop-up events? There's no place where it's just a repair shop that's open all the time that you can go?
There are things like tool libraries where they have classes and stuff like that, uh-huh. But there's no permanent. The things, I am not aware of anything permanent that people have done. Have you heard of anything? And even Repair Public, I don't know if this is something that they came up with in Greenfield.
Yeah,
they
I'm not clear about that either.
Or if it's another kind of franchisee kind of thing. The Repair Cafe, I think it's been used as kind of it's become more of a generic term than maybe it should, like Kleenex or something.
Right.
But what they do is they provide guidelines, and they're helpful, you know, very helpful guidelines, and they also provide design templates and stuff like that if we choose to use them. So the other thing that I just wanted to say is as we, in talking to Diana and Roger, there are kind of key things that need to happen. We need to have some kind of a working group, organizing group, like we do for the recenter. And so far we have Diana and Roger. I also threw posts about the Repair Cafe. I have a couple of volunteers that have sent us emails for wanting to get involved, including Dave Giese, who is, we all know from his help with deconstruction and construction of Recenter. So that's number one. Number two, we need to think about what kind of co-organizers or co-sponsors that we might want to get. This fellow who spoke about the Bolton, he worked with the Rotary Club in Bolton. There's also things like the Kiwanis, Lions Club, there's various, Ham Radio Club. There's different organizations that might want to help us organize this.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a call into
I'd be happy to be the outreach person to those places.
That's great.
Places.
That's great, David. Thank you. I'm going to write your name down here. The fourth thing is I'm getting experts recruited. Let me back up a little bit. So co-organizers, sponsors, we thought hardware stores might be interested in becoming involved somehow. I have a call in to Smith Folk, food sponsors, those types of things to kind of brainstorm. And then the experts recruited, and that's where some of those clubs are really will come into play. Although some of them might also want to
maybe the kitchen
sponsor.
Store in town?
Whatever it's called. It's got a new name now, huh? So organizing, finding partners, collecting experts, and then the fourth is tools and materials. And sometimes the experts bring their own stuff if they're comfortable doing that. Sometimes they won't want to or they'll need extra stuff. And getting lists of things that we could use would be useful because then we can collect it at the recenter as it comes in, et cetera.
Is there DEP money for this sort of thing?
I have to find out to see if we can spend it on the grant from the grant. I don't see why not, but I'm not the decision maker.
Right.
So,
but they haven't, it's not on their radar, the DEP.
Oh, I think Repair Cafes are on their
radar. It is?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. It's not, as we're doing a lot of groundbreaking stuff, so they're watching and listening. We're not the only ones, and in fact, the Repair Cafes and iFixits have been, Cambridge and Somerville have had stuff going on.
Mm-hmm.
So they're aware of that. I don't know how much they're aware of Pittsfield so much, but they are definitely, it's on their radar screen. So the fifth thing is volunteers. It would be something like the toy exchange in that it would need a good amount of volunteers, nowhere near the amount that the toy exchange needs. But we would need, people for the setup crew, reception, administration table, some places have kids tables, checkout tables, where people give donations and write kind of reviews of their experience.
So right now, Susan, you're planning on having two repair cafes. Is that right?
No, it's just it's potential. We're not planning on anything yet.
Oh, I thought you mentioned September.
We have two dates that are reserved in our calendar that would work for it potentially.
I'm just wondering about using Sign Up Genius to get volunteers, to add it on to those Saturday morning, because it's going to be at the recenter, right?
No, it'd be at Smith Folk.
Oh, these are going to be at Smith Folk. They're not going to be at the
It's a pop-up event. And we want to make it convenient to everybody, and if we can get Smith Folk, especially their adult education people involved, that would be great.
And it's all weathered that way.
Yeah, so Roger also said that they often have musicians, to kind of help have a fun atmosphere, and so he knows some musicians. So the next step is to identify look at those communities that have them already, develop a list of questions, very similar to what we did with the swap shop, and at, you know, do some reconnoitering and find out, reconnaissance, I guess, is what, I'm not reconnoitering. Do some reconnaissance and find out what issues they have, what we can learn from what's already been done. And so we already started a list like that. I would like to get a group, get Roger and Diana and Dave Giese and invite these other people as well, and David too, if you're interested, and get have start having some working meetings.
Stan, was he interested in being involved?
He was interested in the recenter, so. Mm-hmm.
I don't know if he's on our sign-up genius list.
I think I have his contact info.
I definitely have it because I use him for Berkshire Natural. But,
Yeah. So lots of exciting stuff, good stuff. The big question is this, you know, you can start small and kind of build from there, or we can wait until September and have it more carefully thought out and oiled and prepared kind of event. So
go small first.
Should we set a date to meet?
Well, Roger works, so I mean he has a work schedule.
So not
schedule,
without him.
So I think
yes,
it would be hard to
set
do.
A date.
Yes, we should. Yeah. Yes, we should. And I.
I don't think that decision can be made about what event we're going to have until we sit together and figure
right.
out exactly who has time to do what
right.
and what needs to happen.
Right. I mean, it would be a stretch to make something happen well by June. But on the other hand, if you just had, you know, bicycle repair, you know, we could probably have three different people and just advertise those three
mm-hmm.
skills. And
yeah.
Would we, I mean, couldn't we integrate it into the rigid plastics event at Smith Folk?
Why? We could, yes, yes, we could.
Just because we're going to be there, this is a thing that's going to take place at Smith Folk, and it's an event that
uh-huh.
people come to that we could at least promote it, if not actually have a repair cafe. Have some sort of a table
we should promote.
That's
absolutely.
Just
yeah.
dedicated to promoting.
Absolutely.
It feels like a pull on volunteers to combine that. It feels like they're...
Well, except unless there's going to be different volunteers for the repair cafe.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Yeah, interesting thought. And that's something we could maybe think about in the future, combining those. It could be difficult if in the spring, because the farmer's market is in the cafeteria. And that's where we would probably want to be.
I think they're done. They're pretty.
In April?
May.
May is it?
May? Okay.
I think they're in May.
Okay.
I have to go. I'm sorry. So.
Yeah. Oh, a bummer. I'm sorry. Well, then we're not going to have a quorum. Bummer.
Oh.
Well, we can still
no,
meet.
I
we just can't make decisions.
You said you had to leave.
I have to go early.
Yeah. So.
Do you need to vote on
anything? I don't think so. No. I don't. Before you go, I'm going to. If it's okay with you, David, I'm going to skip ahead to the event dates revisited. This is our final event slate. I put the house hazardous household waste collection on there because
you got it. Nice.
Because the public wants this information and Deb gives these out. So
great.
We have moved the date of the spring rally to March to May 6th from April 29th.
Isn't that the SOS?
No, the
oh, that's
SOS
the 15th.
Is the
13th.
That's
always the
that's
second,
why
so.
It got
yeah.
moved. Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah. So, yeah. And these are all reserved, and I just got the thumbs up from Tim Smith that we're set for these dates.
And did you see you had reserved at Smith Folk also the September and June dates already or not?
Yes, I have.
Which dates are those?
The September and June dates,
You have, oh no.
This is really nice, Susan.
Yeah, yeah, this is very readable.
Okay, the potential dates for the repair cafes are... June 10th and September 16th.
That fills our schedule.
So those have, and I can update this once we know, once we have more sense of what's going to happen. I mean, I could, in fact, before this goes public, I could add the September date if what do you think, Diane? You think I should add the September date?
Yeah, I guess so. And then if we can do a June, we'll just pop it in. It'll be sort of a trial balloon anyway.
Okay. Yeah, well, I'll do that later this morning. I'll add it in. Well, now, we should probably call it something, I don't want to necessarily say repair cafe unless we want to be sure that we're going to do repair cafe and sign on to their whole thing.
Repair event.
That's great.
So, the rigid plastics event was piloted in Bay State just for Bay State residents. Mm-hmm. However many years ago we did that. Mm-hmm. We could do the same thing.
Just have
a neighborhood. It doesn't have to be at Smith Voke. That particular one was in the parking lot across from the cutlery building. Mm-hmm. And it was very well attended, mm-hmm. because Bay State Association has a Google group, a listserv. We filled, I think, two dumpsters. So obviously it was really well attended and it was incredibly educational. In fact, I would argue that if you have too many people, you don't learn enough because you're just busy trying to get it done and manage the people. Yeah. So if you can manage the number of people that come in, I think you can learn a lot more.
I think
that's
a great idea, David.
Was the Bay State Association doing it or?
Well, no, we did it, our group did it, but we invited Bay State residents, only Bay State residents, to bring their rigid plastics.
So, but repair cafe definitely outdoor. I mean, not outdoors. Somewhere undercover. Yes.
Well, that event happens to be outdoors. So I don't know. Does a repair cafe have to be inside?
It really needs. It doesn't have to be. I mean, I think of the people we heard speak said that they did it out in a park, but it makes
we can
electrical.
Do it at the Fiker School if we want to do Bay State.
Mm-hmm. What?
Mm-hmm. Fiker School?
Uh-huh.
It's a city. Oh, actually, it's not a city building any longer.
They sold it.
But Leslie is, the director of the building, right. So that would be an easy thing to make happen.
Uh-huh.
I'm sure she'd probably enjoy something like
uh-huh.
that. By the way, Leslie does intend to supervise. She just couldn't make that meeting the other day. Her grandchild is still in the hospital.
Oh, my God.
Now, they got all the organs back into the body, but, that kid's, I think, a year old.
Oh, my goodness.
That's a long time.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. And where is the child?
In New Jersey.
In New Jersey.
Yeah.
My goodness.
So, anyway, if you wanted to do Bay State, Fiker School would be an idea. It would be interesting to see if CET would loan us their offices to do it. Talk about, common interest.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
They were not in the cutlery building when we had this rigid plastics event, way back when.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Northampton Karate is also in the cutlery building. I know the owner of that, so we could do it there. So there's some Bay State options if you want to do it.
Okay. That's great. So I'm really excited about this. I think it's funny because I'm getting involved in this effort to see if we can get a food cooperative in Amherst. The easiest thing would be just to have River Valley open one in Amherst, but that's not going to happen anytime soon. But
take 12 years to do it.
Yeah. Well, so that's the thing.
It took 12 years for us to do it just because of the real estate.
Yeah. Oh, was that the main reason? Yeah.
Because it was actually very similar to the Recenter.
Uh-huh.
We were both just focused on being downtown.
Yeah.
And that's what prevented it for many years.
Interesting. Well, so my point is that I'm right now in it, because of what's going on in the country and the concerns and fears that people have, a cooperative is a food co-op is an attractive thing because it gives the local community more control. And so similarly, this repair cafe concept is, and so much of what we do in general, the recenter, it's community based, it's strengthening our community, it's providing potential economic
opportunities
to our community. There's just so many good things about the stuff that we're doing and the repair cafe right now. Not even right now. There's so many good things, period, but in particular, because of the climate that we're working in, I just feel like we're, you know, it's just really needed and we're on a good trajectory.
Susan, from what I understand about the co-op in Northampton, mm-hmm. it's been a tremendous financial success.
They have blown away
So why would there be any trouble getting one started in Amherst?
That's a good question.
You know, there's funding from the National Cooperative mm-hmm. Group, which is part of where the Northampton one got their funding. Yeah. I think if you had a board, board together.
We need to talk, David, because
I'm going to join the board of the Northampton
co-op. Oh, excellent.
Co-op.
Excellent. Well, so part of the challenge is that Amherst is different from Northampton in makeup and in the level of participation that
is
the community
it? Is
has.
It truly?
I think it is, and many people have agreed with me, so it's not something that you can really measure. But there are a lot of people that believe have values that they think are important, but they're much, much less apt to get in there and do something about it. That's one of the things, frankly, that attracted me to Northampton and you guys when I had to make my decision of where to work, is that you guys are much more willing to dive in and make stuff happen. And mm-hmm. I had a little of that in Amherst, but more of, we think this is a good idea. Isn't this a great idea? You know, so there's just a much more kind of, and this is more my intuition than anything, but much more willingness to throw your towel, not throw your towel in, but you know, throw your
get your hands dirty.
Get your hands dirty, absolutely. So that's part of it. The other part I think that prevents it in Amherst is, or that's a challenge in Amherst is that we're very close to a bunch of grocery stores, and those grocery stores, in addition, you know, so there's Whole Foods plus the two grocery stores in Hadley have recently expanded their natural foods areas. So people are like, well, I can get natural foods. Why should I get them at a co-op? And so that's an educating.
Well, if you
education.
Can open, it's a location, location, location. If you can open up downtown, it doesn't matter what Whole Foods has.
Well, but not only that, the whole concept of a co-op isn't just about selling natural foods. There's a whole lot of other powerful things about a co-op. And if Northampton can support many grocery stores and a co-op, why can't Amherst?
So the church down, as you get from the middle of town, going down, not Amherst, had in the back every Wednesday, because I was a member, they had a pop-up co-op, mm-hmm. basically. Mm-hmm. The church was very involved with that. Mm-hmm. So if you look to do it through that, through mm-hmm. the church membership they've already had experience with it 30 years ago or something. You know?
So I digress, but my point was that there's some, because of the political climate, there's a lot of really powerful things that can happen. Hopefully we can channel people's energy into making some things happen. And I think the Repair Cafe is one of them.
Just one added note. Bay State has a townwide tag sale somewhere around May, June, mm-hmm. so that might be it.
That's new?
No, they've had it every year.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't remember you mentioning that in the past. Did they have it here?
No,
they have it in Springfield?
No, Bay State townwide tag sale.
Oh, yeah, yeah, that's what I have to do.
And where is Bay State? You guys keep Riverside talking about Bay State.
So
below the high school.
Yeah.
Oh, that's where like where Joan lives.
No, she lives above. So if you go down past the high school, you go down a hill. Where the back entrance to the hospital is.
Okay.
On Nonotuck Street.
Uh-huh.
But Riverside Drive goes along the Mill River.
Okay.
And it ends. It doesn't end, but it comes to the Cutlery Building. You know where the Clement Street Bridge is?
No.
All right, so it's part of Northampton. You haven't driven around a lot.
Yeah,
but,
no.
We're just a few hundred yards from it, but it was housing that was built for mill workers.
Okay.
So the properties are really small.
Uh-huh.
The houses are adorable.
Oh, I'd love to see it. That sounds great.
It is the definition of a neighborhood.
Uh-huh.
It's really,
really,
really
nice.
Great. Yeah.
Nice.
And it's well defined by Riverside Drive, Nonotuck, mm-hmm. and it still continues to be Riverside Drive. And
it's called
Dog
River,
Lake to
River
the
Road.
Has it become River Road?
I think that's
it.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Great.
By Mansfield.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
The State of the Union thing that I wanted to do, I really would like to have, first of all, a quorum, not because we're voting, but just because I'd like to have more people, so I would like to postpone it until next month, if that's okay with people.
I don't know what it is, so that's
yeah,
fine.
I just wanted to reflect back, you know, take a step back, reflect back, and talk about what our committee is. I didn't know what else to call it. You know, it's
okay.
Not like we're...
Yeah.
It's a discussion necessarily. It's more just kind of a check-in, sort of.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd like to do that when there's more people here.
Right.
And so then we're on to new business.
Okay.
And the only thing that I have is we do have the rate sheets for this for the Earth Day insert. So I wanted to encourage you guys, if you know people who should be advertising in this because of their sustainable organization or that they're involved with anything to do with waste reduction or would benefit from being associated with it, I encourage you to take some of these and hand them out. The rates are based on the fact that this insert goes into three papers with a total of about 100,000 readers in Pioneer Valley. There's very few, if any, inserts that do that. So this it's very wide-reaching in the Pioneer Valley. It goes in the Shelburne Falls newsstand issues of their newspaper as well. It gets given out at DPWs throughout this valley. So the rates are higher than they would be in the Gazette for a reason. And it's also something that people hang on to. People hang on to their copies. So. It's over the years has been built up into a really excellent publication, and we're celebrating our 10th year this year. And the theme, as I said, is a reclaim compost, but I'm hoping to kind of do a little twist and say reclaim food, reclaim wasted food, not just reclaim food waste, but reclaim wasted food, and have some discussion in there about food reclamation for food banks and survival centers and stuff like that.
Do you know mean compost in that case?
Yeah, well, compost, yeah.
I mean,
so compost is kind of what the lead article is about, but I would like to expand that a little beyond. And I'm not sure that we're going to be able to have that happen because there is limited space, but that's one of my personal kind of revelations over the last week or so I need to talk to my partner. So I have more if you want, but it's a really great opportunity for certain organizations. I've been very disappointed that more used clothing places and antique places and stuff like that haven't stepped up.
Well, small businesses,
we
really
tried
small.
To have, there are small businesses, but we tried to do a page of small businesses where they
business
could just do a little
size.
Business card size, and it they didn't step up to that either. Now, it's possible now that we have more of a reputation that they would be more willing to do that, but I think it's going to require somebody to get out on the ground and get those places, sign them on individually, mm-hmm. because I don't think the ad reps at the Gazette have a lot of contact with those types of organizations always.
That means they'd have to take an eighth of a page? Or
smaller. You know, I mean, that's the thing. I mean, if we, you know, some next year, it's too late for this year, but maybe next year we'll try again for the reuse marketplace kind of page and let them do a business card size,
yeah.
which would be even smaller than an eighth of a page. But anyway, it's, you know, if you can get someone to do the larger ads, it's easier. So why bother with the smaller ads?
When you're done, I hope.
I'm done.
Okay. I know we are the reuse committee,
mm-hmm.
and that is our charge.
Mm-hmm.
But the truth is that a community and a government, a municipal government, will only kind of endeavor into new worlds generally when its citizens want to endeavor into those new worlds.
Mm-hmm.
And part of the reason that we have our pop-up events, that we have composting at the transfer station, it's because this committee has really pushed
it's an advisory
to make
committee.
It happen. So my question to you, Susan, as the big picture person is,
mm-hmm.
what is it that Northampton lacks? I mean, you know, the ReUse Center is terrific. The ReUse Center, you know, Peter has really grand ideas about how we can expand our solid waste reduction. Recycling has its limitations. What is it that we're missing? What's the component that we're missing that would do more to address solid waste reduction? We know that if we educated people about being conscious of their purchases,
mm-hmm.
purchasing less,
yeah.
noticing their packaging. So is that the missing piece? Or are there other things that we should be, that if we were to do a long range plan,
yeah.
and we were to say, okay, 10 years from now,
mm-hmm.
what would we be doing?
What would Northampton
we'd have
be
a
doing?
Reuse center, we'd have repair cafes,
mm-hmm.
we'd have community-wide compost. What are the other elements? What are the pieces that we're missing that we need to have?
I need to think, I'd need to chew on that for a little bit.
Well, it's
but
new business,
I feel
so I would say
strongly,
for the next meeting
right?
would be great, just because, and in terms of the committee State of the Union,
mm-hmm.
we should be thinking about these. I mean, it took us a couple of years to get the repair cafe to the point where we were ready to commit to a date.
Well, we had other things going on.
Well, no, but the point is that even if we just start the discussion now,
right,
and 4 years from now, we have that next element. We start
right.
planning toward that.
Right.
That would be, I think, a
yep.
good
yep.
long-range goal
yep.
for the committee.
Yep. Okay.
A reused rocket to the moon.
My... you asked me, was it were you asking in a
rhetorical
way, or?
I'm not actually. I'm
okay.
asking because you spend more time thinking about this
mm-hmm.
stuff
mm-hmm.
than everybody else, and you're involved in DEP discussions, and I'm sure you're thinking about this already. So the question is, I mean, Peter's thinking about it all the time, and he has a plan,
mm-hmm.
But. And maybe whatever you recommend will
right.
fit into what Peter's plan is. Maybe it'll be parallel. It doesn't
right.
really matter. But
right.
I think it'd be interesting for this committee to have a discussion. I don't know, for me, if you were to ask me that question, I would say community-wide education about the importance of reducing waste, about really taking responsibility for your purchases
mm-hmm.
so that consumption is lower.
Right, absolutely. And I would agree with you, but I don't... But that's hard to do.
Yeah.
It's expensive and it's hard to do. So how can you motivate that those changes in different ways? And I think the repair cafes and the stuff that we're doing is already doing it. The recenter, it's building a culture of respect for what exists, respect for repair and restoration. All of that, and that is the way that we're going to help change behavior, because ultimately there are just too many forces that are encouraging people to consume. We're a consumer, you know, that's a major base of a major part of our economy. It is our economy is consumption. So we're fighting against a really big tide, a really powerful tide. And so by focusing on our community and how we can encourage our community to grow and think differently through these programs, I think is a really powerful way to do it. I have been a little disillusioned by recycling. It's a great thing, but there are some concerns, and you talk to waste management and some of these big organizations that do recycling, with the cost of petroleum being so low, the market for recycled plastics is struggling. And so the costs that are a normal part of doing business need to be paid for, and if there isn't a market for the end product, you know, you've got some problems. So those are things that we're coming up against, and it's not that recycling is not important, but it has forced me to look beyond recycling to how else can we make an impact to get people to think about all the single-use plastic that they're using and consuming. And so that would, yeah, I agree with you. It's getting people to think differently, and that's a big task.
I have a suggestion, which we're already doing. The tag sale is the culture of, yeah, I don't have to buy it new. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's not the consumption that's the problem, it's the having to have it be brand new stuff. Mm-hmm. All of it has to be brand new all the time. Doesn't work, throw it out, buy another one. You know, that's where the industry got us to. Mm-hmm. Cars, and 50s cars starting out, you know, no, right. 3 years you got to buy another one. So right. Having, and Europeans are much better at this, you know, they, flea markets have been going on there for thousand years. Here, it's very few people have the confidence to buy stuff, who don't right. regularly go to tag sales, have the confidence to buy something.
And some of that is because of the marketing and et cetera. I mean, if you look at one of the latest posts that I made on Facebook, it was about children of baby boomers don't want their parents' stuff. And I posted something like this before, and there was a new article, and I posted this one. And it's interesting to see what the comments are. And one person talked about how toxic all the old stuff was, which is something that we need to be aware of.
That's
because
valid.
People, you know, there was lead paint, there was, you know, does that mean that we should not touch it and that we should only buy new stuff that doesn't have lead paint on it? That's a question for everybody to make on, you know, that's a decision everyone to make on their own, but we need to be aware of that to help fight against that, because mm-hmm. there's pros and cons, because the older material tended to be very well made.
Yeah.
So even if it had lead paint on it, if it's going to last for 50 years or 100 years, and new stuff from IKEA is going to last for 10, you know, if you're lucky, you know, mm-hmm. so there's some pros and cons, and that whole discussion and that whole discussion needs to be out there and promoted. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Not too much lead paint on furniture ever.
Well, it was interesting, and she had a point, but I didn't know how much of that is not overreaction, but you know, there sometimes manufacturers or producers will introduce a fear-based kind of tactic to prevent people from feeling comfortable doing something that goes against their business model. So for instance, the plastic bag industry was sending out all this information about how unsanitary it was to reuse bags, and that, you know,
salmonella
and all this stuff. This was a fear-based tactics to fight against the movement to get people to reuse bags. And so when you read some of the recommended stuff, they say that you should wash the bags every time after each use, and you should do this and that. And you know, it's so, but it works because people get scared. Mm-hmm. So is this, you know, toxic, the old stuff is all toxic stuff, is that just kind of a something that's happening in reaction to this reuse movement? I don't know. It certainly, there is truth to it, just like there is truth that salmonella can be, you know, carried, but how much of it is, what are the odds of it really happening, and is it something that really needs to be a concern for people?
I haven't licked a 1920s chest or sideboard because it doesn't taste very good. But as an example, that stuff was so unpopular soon after that along comes a reuse, which is turn it into shabby chic. Mm-hmm. This style that suddenly came out, which I thought was god awful because they're using crappy furniture to start with, made in the 20s and 30s.
But so the furniture in the 20s and 30s was not well made?
It was some of the first very mass-produced stuff.
Yeah, very, they call it, there's a place in Michigan that, anyway, this style with that and whacked together, and just, it was not actually very well assembled.
So what happened in the 40s?
Well, there wasn't so much new in the 40s because of the war, but then afterwards, here we have Haywood Wakefield and some of the companies out in Gardner that made outstanding furniture. I mean, modern furniture that's quality.
But your point was to not just talk about what we're doing next month, but to look at where that's we right. want to be years from now. What right. is it that we could be doing that maybe we're not? And that's just right. have that discussion. We
Correct.
Started that now, but that was your point.
Yeah.
I need to get going. Yeah, we need yeah. next meeting.
Yeah. So next
we were adjourned
folks,
as soon as Diana left because we didn't have a quorum any longer. So.
Oh, well, we'll see you in the next meeting. But
yeah, next meeting, we cannot meet on the 9th or the 2nd of March because I'm going to be out of town.
Okay.
And so it needs to be on the 16th, which
that's
would
good.
Be the third Thursday. I'm sorry about that, but
well, it's a month
okay.
from now, so
I won't yeah. be here, but that's fine.
Okay.
You can't not be here. We don't know what we talked about.
Yeah.
Where will you be?
For doing that?
March. I'll be on the road.
On the road.
Going sorry. South. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think we'll be in Savannah for a few days.
Mm-hmm. I'm going south too. So, Are we good? I guess
we're
don't
good.
Need to officially adjourn.
Nope.
But thank you, everybody.
Okay. Very nice. Bye.